I hope all of you are enjoying just like I am. So today we are going to be talking about three pillars of continuous security. So my name is Meera. I work for a company called Subbarao. I work as a senior principal consultant. I'm also the director of the secure development practice. I have been actually using Jenkins since the day it was called Hudson, right? From the day, it's almost 10 years now. I have written a lot of plugins for Jenkins. I do a lot of consulting for clients where, we know we have like hundreds of plugins, open source plugins, but then none of them are really what you require, right? So one of the main reasons I wanted to do this talk was to talk about security, right? A lot of us talk about QA, we talk about performance testing, but then none of us focus much on software security, right? So you see a lot of pictures there. You see a car, you see an Apple Watch. By the way, I have one. You see games, right? We see software everywhere in the world, right? And then we do write software for every one of these, right? But for some reason, we don't focus so much on the software vulnerabilities, right? So a lot of the companies focus more on perimeter security, that is firewalls, antivirus software, but then that's not actually enough, right? So what happens if there's an attack? I usually prepare like one or two incidents every time I do a talk, but then every time I come back and go online the next day morning and see, there's always new attacks, right? If you went and read the newspapers today, one of the key things was there was an attack on the Olympic Committee in the US, right, where they had taken a lot of the information, right? So every day as you keep going and seeing, you will see a lot of these, attacks or hacks being done every single day, right? So what are some of the consequences of these? Yeah, you see a lot of financial loss. If you are in a credit card industry, you see a lot of customers who you lose. You lose a lot of reputation. There is data loss, right? Say suppose you have credit card information, social security information, passwords. We see that time and again, change your passwords, right? So again, none of us focus so much on security than we focus on functionality, right? So why is that? It's common everywhere. So as a principal consultant, as a person who does a lot of risk analysis, threat modeling, over the past few years, I see that a lot of companies are now trying to build security in their CI, CD, and DevOps environment, right? So one of the key things is everyone ignores the past. They don't worry about what happened. They lose the business context, right? A lot of the companies focus more on perimeter security, like I mentioned. No one actually tests for security, right? We put a lot of focus on functionality, and then most of the places where I have traveled, security is always viewed as negative, right? So there is a lot of activities which we do. So this is something which we share at Digital Alert, the software security touch point. Doesn't matter what methodology you're using. Maybe you're using waterfall, you're using agile. It doesn't matter, right? So you have to start when you're doing your requirements and use case. You start with your abuse cases. You start with your security requirements, and you also perform a risk analysis, right? And then as soon as you have your test plans, you perform something called as a risk-based security test. So then once you start developing your code, that is when you actually start focusing on CI, right? Because that's when you say, okay, I want to start using Jenkins. That is when you start also using all your code review tools, right? And then once you finish your development, you have a staging environment, you deploy your code to your staging environment, that is where you perform your penetration testing, right? And then once you finish all of these, yes, your application goes into production, and then you get the feedback from the field, right? So someone hacks into your system, and then you get all the feedback. So in today's talk, I primarily want to focus on two things. One is the code review tools. The other one is your penetration testing tools. Those are the two tools which are primarily used in all of your CI and CD environments, where a lot of the companies try to integrate in their daily builds, nightly builds, or weekly builds. And that is where we see a lot of the challenges, right? So what is the main difference between both of these tools, right? What's the difference between a static analysis versus a dynamic analysis, right? So one of them is your white box. When you're doing static code analysis, you look at the code, right? So you have your code at your fingertips, and you can go deep into the code and then do a code review, right? The tools which you use, whether you use commercial tools or you use open source tools, they act just like your compiler, right? So on the other hand, when you say you want to do dynamic analysis, it's a black box. You have already deployed your application, maybe in your staging environment, and then you again use commercial, or there are a lot of open source tools, and then it does the scanning just like a normal user does, right? So when you talk about static analysis, it's all about prevention. Right, so you take a lot of measures to prevent something happening, whereas dynamic analysis is all about verification. Do I have this injection vulnerability, maybe SQL injection, or don't I have it, right? So again, static analysis can be used way early in your life cycle. So as soon as you start writing a single line of code, you can start using your static analysis tools. But then when you say talk about dynamic analysis, it's all the way on the right side, right? We always hear now companies saying move to the left, right? So when you're talking about dynamic analysis, you're waiting until you have the application which is built, which is in your production, and then you do your testing, right? So again, both of them, whether it's static analysis or dynamic analysis, find lots of issues, right? But then the problem is, when you do static analysis, you can go through the entire code base. So your coverage is 100%. Whereas when you're doing dynamic analysis, since you don't have that much time, maybe you can cover 50% of your application, right? But the challenging part here is, any time when I do either a static analysis or a dynamic analysis engagement with a client, the results from dynamic analysis are very, very convincing to the developers, right? Because you have a screenshot and you say, see, I can show you that there is a SQL injection vulnerability. I can show you that it's a cross-site scripting vulnerability, right? But then when you're doing static analysis, the only thing you have is the code, right? So you say, okay, you're not doing parameterized SQL queries, you're doing string concatenation, which is really bad. But then when the developers come back and say, can you prove it to me? I cannot prove it, right? So that is the biggest challenge which we always go through when we are doing either static or dynamic analysis. Again, which is less cheaper for the developers to fix? It's always your static analysis, right? Because you're writing your code, you check in your code, again, and in the night, you build it through Jenkins. You run one of your static analysis tools, you immediately find a SQL injection. So you break the build, and then the developer goes and fixes it. Whereas if you don't have a static analysis tool, you're running it, you have this vulnerability all the while, you push it into your staging environment, somebody runs a penetration test, and then now to come back and fix the issue is very, very expensive, right? So there's always a challenge, do we do static analysis or do we do dynamic analysis? But then if you dig deeper into both of these, both of them find different kinds of vulnerabilities. Both of them are used at different times in your SDLC, right? So there's no one size fits all, right? So you cannot say I'm doing dynamic analysis, I am covered, I don't want to do static analysis. Or you cannot say that I am doing static analysis, I don't want to do dynamic analysis, right? So that is something which is really challenging. So one of the key things I wanted to talk about based on almost 8 years of my experience, especially at Citadel, deploying these static and dynamic analysis, building them into the SDLC, is the challenges, right? So a lot of companies assume that, okay, I paid $1 million, I bought the static analysis tool, I am done, right? A lot of the companies assume that I bought this dynamic analysis tool, I paid another $500,000, now I am done, right? So they bring the tool, they assume that, okay, we are done, now we are secure, right? So that is not how continuous security works. So there are three aspects which I really want to focus on today. That is the people, the process, as well as the technology, right? So you have all the tools. You know how to automate using Jenkins. You have learned a lot of information about Jenkins. Maybe yesterday, today, and tomorrow, you're going to learn even more things about the pipeline and everything else. But then, if you don't have the right people, you don't have the right process, then all of this automation which you have is not going to help, right? So that is some of the challenges which we want to cover today in all three of them. Like, what are the people challenges? What are the challenges we face using process? And what are the challenges we face using the technology itself, right? So first thing first, we all know this, right? I was a developer before I joined Citadel. I had worked as a Java EE, it was called J2 EE at that time, developer for 10 years before I joined Citadel. So when I first came to Citadel for an interview, the first question they asked is, what is SQL injection? I had never heard anything about SQL injection. So I was like, I don't know what is SQL injection. They asked me a lot of questions about security. I didn't know anything, right? But slowly and steadily, I started learning a lot of the activities which we perform at Citadel. And then from being a software developer, now I moved all the way to being a software security principal consultant, right? Or a director of a practice owning at Citadel. So not all of the places, when I talk to people, the first thing they say is, oh, we don't have any software security people. I'm like, why don't you train your developers? The next thing they say is, no, developers cannot be security experts. They go on and on and on, they argue, and then at the end I say, you are talking to me, I didn't do a PhD in software security. I was just a developer. I knew all the languages, right? I mean, when I say all the languages, 10 years back, it was Java and .NET, right? I knew the languages, and then I did a lot of continuous integration. Earlier, even before Jenkins or Hudson, we had something called as cruise control. So I had used cruise control all the way from the beginning, writing all the XML files, creating a dashboard and things like that, right? So I became a director of a group at Citadel. When I can do it, why cannot other people do it, right? So one of the biggest challenges here is in all of the companies where I go is the emphasis is completely different, right? As developers, we are asked to push a lot of functionality into production, right? So on the other side, on the software security group side, the key is different. You need to find more and more functionality or issues, right, in your code. So, and not all the places do we have software developers who are security experts, right? And all of the places where I have seen, it's very rare that you see security experts who have done a lot of development. So there's always this tug of war between the SSG, which is the software security group, as well as your software developers, right? So unless you bridge this gap, however you do it in your organization, there is no way they get along, right? So that is one of the challenges. The next challenge we have is, we have very limited software security resources, right? right? So this is from a recent study which Sujital has done, where for every 75 developers, you have one software security person, right? Say suppose if you do a scan, you run static analysis through Jenkins, it finds, I'm not sure how many of you have run those tools, when you run that tool, it finds maybe 10,000 issues, right? So you need someone to go look at those 10,000 issues and say, out of this 10,000, these 500 are true positives, right? So if you have one person who is doing that in your organization, imagine what happens, right? So the biggest challenge we all have is that we have very limited number of software security resources, right? The next challenge when you're talking about people, what I see in a lot of the companies I go is the remediation guidance, right? So I go to the developer, they might be using a framework, for example, maybe Java, and they are using Hibernate. I go tell them there's SQL injection in your Hibernate code, you go fix it, right? So the next thing they come back to me and say, I'm using Hibernate, there is no SQL injection in Hibernate, right? So they keep arguing, like for 2 days, 3 days. So if I am a security expert who has never written Hibernate code in a million years, how will I convince them that, yes, you are using Hibernate, but even Hibernate is vulnerable to SQL injection, right? So that is the biggest challenge. So anytime you go talk to the developers and tell them that they need to fix all of this risky code, there is no proper guidance, right? So all of the guidance, yes, a lot of companies have secure coding guidelines. It's a huge Word document. So how will I remember that I need to go look for fixing SQL injection for Hibernate in this huge Word document, right? So the next thing I do is I go Google, right? So, and then once you do that, all the guidance you get from doing all these searches, again, are not consistent, right? So again, in order to avoid all of these, you go to the tool which told that you had SQL injection, you see whatever remediation guidance is there, you copy paste, and then you rerun the scan, right? So since it's not the right remediation, this thing goes on and on and on, and the developer is already very upset, right? So that is one of the biggest challenges we see when we try to automate, whether it is static or dynamic analysis tools, into our daily builds, right? So the next thing we all see is process challenges. Yes, okay, you integrated your tools into your daily builds, into your nightly builds. You have your pipeline, so every time there was a major critical issue, you broke the pipeline, you did a lot of good things, right? But then, when we go to all of these places, no one company has one methodology, right? So you go to a company and then you say, okay, I'm going to help you do CI, CD, CD in the sense continuous delivery for static and dynamic analysis, and then you go talk to them, they're like, okay, this team uses waterfall, this team uses agile, this other team, we have our own methodology, we use that, right? And then you go talk to them, they have different methodologies being used, different build systems being used. Yes, there's one team which uses Jenkins, there's another team which is using Bamboo. So there is no one way wherein you can go when you buy all of these tools and say, I have all of the information I need, I can integrate it easily into their environment. So that is one of the challenges. The next one is, there's no vulnerability lifecycle management. Yes, you have a lot of information for your quality defects, right? So you run your QA test, you run your functional test, you do all of them, you put them in your bug tracking system, but as soon as it comes to security tools, you have a huge PDF file, right? What's the point of having a PDF or an Excel file? If I am the CTO of a company and I need to go look at the metrics, do I send this to staging environment? Do I not send it? I don't have a place where I can go look at the dashboard and say, yes, this application is good, it can go to production, or no, this cannot go into production. right? So there is no accountability for security defects, right? So every time I have done a risk analysis, I have done a threat model for almost majority of the banks, many of the companies you see here, I have gone up and worked there. When you give them a PDF or a Word document, they're like, hey Meera, this is not critical. Can you change it to high? Can you reduce it to medium, right? So they sit and argue with us with all the defects, right? So there is no accountability, especially for security defects, right? And there is no governance. There is no gate for security defects. There are a lot of gates for quality, right? But then as soon as it comes to security, say suppose you are a big banking application which is outside facing, you need to say that, okay, I am not going to allow any type of SQL injection to go into production. Whether it is critical, high, medium, or low, I don't care, right? So there's nothing like that. And then there's no defect tracking at all for security findings, right? And on top of all of those, there's no metrics. So there are very nice dashboards which are available to you, as simple as Sonar Q. But then when you talk about all of these tools, right, when you talk about plugins like finders or PMD, you can push all of these metrics into Sonar Q. But then when you go to the commercial tool side, none of them have metrics, right? So there's no way you have metrics. Yes, you have Excel file, you have PDF files, but then there's no metrics, right? So that is one of the challenges you face when you're doing process management. The next one is there's no way you classify your applications, right, or your software. So there's no risk classification. I don't know whether this application needs to be run on a nightly basis or every checking basis, or it has to be run on a weekly basis. I don't know if an application is outside facing. Is it managing credit card information? Is it managing user information? Unless you have this risk profile for your entire application suite in your company, there is no way you can onboard all of these applications in your CI/CD environment, right? So you should be able to say that, hey, this application is outside facing, it deals with a lot of credit card information, it's a critical application, so I don't need to have any risk in this application. Maybe you have another application which is available only to your internal users, which is intranet, within the intranet, and then you can say that, hey, this is a low risk application, so maybe I need to scope this in such a way that I run the tools on a weekly basis, right? So it is very important to make sure that on top of all your people challenges, you also make sure that you fix your process challenges, right? So the next one we all talk about is technology challenges. Right? So again, it's not one size fits all, or like you see here, tools are not all the ones which catch everything, right? So you bring in all of these tools, commercial tools, you pay millions of dollars, and then at the end of the day, you integrate it with your build environment, and then that's it, right? But then there has to be a human or someone in your SSG who is able to go and interpret the results, right? Because as soon as you do a scan, even for tools simple as finders or any other tool, right? You have a lot of issues. You have to be able to go look at the issues and say, yes, this is good or this is bad, right? So again, you have to have a person in your software security group or in your development group who knows the application well, and then who can say, yes, this is a true positive or this is a false positive, right? And then all of the new kinds of bugs, right? Say, one of the key things is you, without help, none of these tools are able to find all of the new issues, right? So yes, all of these tools are very good in finding issues for web applications. Say, suppose you are writing web services. You are writing REST services. The the tool doesn't find anything, right? So you have to tell the tool what it needs to do. The next again you see here is, yes, all these tools are only able to find implementation bugs. None of them will be able to find your architectural flaws, right? One of the key things you see a lot of, many times, many of you might be on those profiles as well, right? So they lost so many passwords. Would any of these tools find that the company was storing passwords insecurely? No, right? Those are some of the things which you will have to do a risk analysis or something in order to find those architectural flaws. And then last but not the least is the code cannot certify that if you don't find any issues, your code is very good, right? So you run your static analysis tools, maybe for web applications, it finds like 20,000 issues. The same tool you run on your web services application, it finds zero issues. So a lot of companies assume that, okay, the tool did not find anything for my web services, so everything is good. And then it goes to the next stage, and the penetration testing team finds a lot of issues. They have come back to us many times and said, hey, you did a static analysis. You didn't find any of these issues, right? So one of the things is that anytime you buy any of these tools, you need to make sure that you tailor it to the applications which you are using, right? And all of you might have heard the story of boy crying wolf, right? So same thing with all of these tools. There are a lot of false positives, right? So when a tool finds 20,000 issues, no way are all those 20,000 issues real issues. So we sit there with the tool scans, triage them, and then say out of those 20,000, maybe 100 are true positives, right? And then there are a lot of places where there are more false negatives. That is, the tool doesn't even know about it. Say suppose you are using a framework like Spring Security in Java, where a lot of the authentication, a lot of the authorization you do in your XML files, the tool doesn't know anything about those things, right? So you will see a lot of false negatives as well. So a lot of findings doesn't mean that your application is at a high risk, right? Because like I said, there are a lot of false positives, so you need to be able to go back, look at the application and say, okay, this is it, these are a lot of false positives, right? And then again, when you go back and say that anytime you have more findings, it doesn't mean that the code is less safer, or if you have less findings, does it mean that you have the application is riskier, right? So again, it is very important as a development team or as a security team to go look at all the false positives as well as false negatives, right? And then the last challenge when it comes to technology is no one size fits all, right? So the biggest challenge here is, especially when you're buying all of these commercial tools, all of the companies have different languages. Within the different language, they use different versions. Maybe it is different versions of Java, different versions of Python. They use different build tools. One application might be using Ant, the other one might be using Maven, the third one might be using Gradle, right? There are a lot of technologies which are being used. You see a lot of web services nowadays. You see a lot of REST services, microservices, a lot of different architecture as well, right? So yeah, you might have web services, you might have messaging on one side, and then there are a lot of frameworks, especially if you're using Java, you see that they use the companies use a lot of open source frameworks, right? So Spring, even within Spring, if it is many APIs, right? So you see a lot of those in the images there. You see web applications, you see EJB applications, you see JMS, you have the JPA. So there are a lot of lot of technologies, a lot of the companies, right? So the biggest challenge here is, yes, you bought a tool for maybe a lot of money. Is it going to scan all of your portfolio, right? So which is never the case. So that is, these are some of the key challenges which I have seen as we have started integrating a lot of these commercial tools in the CI/CD environment, right? Whether it is static or dynamic analysis. So what has something which has worked in all of these cases? So a few recommendations here. One is the people itself, right? So a lot of places, we do a lot of training, right? So if the company is writing a lot of applications in Java, we have a lot of defensive programming in Java. Say you're writing something in Ruby and Rails, you do a lot of training in those specific languages. You also train all of these developers in the tools which you are using, right? So you need to make sure that you train your developers in using all of these tools effectively, right? How do they interpret the scan results? How do they know that it is a true positive? How do they know that they need to write additional custom rules in order to enhance the capability of the tool, right? And then the next thing is you have to write, build a process, right? So again, without any process, there is no way any of your developers will go back, look at all of the findings, especially the security findings, and fix the issue, right? And then the last one which you see here is technology. Is you have to understand that all of these tools need a lot of hand-holding, right? So yes, they are the sales team, they say a lot of things, right? By experience, this is, that's why I put there. They aren't plug and play like the vendor mentioned. So there is a lot of argument which goes on back and forth between companies and myself when I tell them that no, the tool doesn't do this. They're like, yes, we were told that it does that, right? So it is very important to understand that you cannot just bring in a tool, say, okay, I'm going to integrate it with my CI environment and then run the tool, right? So one of the biggest challenges which you can overcome is by seeing that your SSG cannot do everything, right? So you have to provide your developers with security training, right? You tell them, like, okay, you educate them what are the common vulnerabilities which you're seeing in your organization. Maybe you're seeing cross-site scripting, maybe you're seeing SQL injection. Explain to them, help them, right? Give them hands-on experience on how do they look for these issues and how do they fix these issues, right? So in all the way in the second or third slide, you saw that there's only one security champion out of 75 developers. Right? So build these security champions within your organization, right? So you see someone who is inclined in using these tools, help them understand how do they run the tool, how do they triage the results, how do they onboard these applications into Jenkins, right? How do they prioritize the results and actually at the end remediate the results, right? So that is something which is very important to understand. And the next thing is give responsibility to your developers, right? So a lot of cases, what we do is all the quality findings are in one place. All the security findings, like I mentioned, is either in a PDF or in a spreadsheet. Stop that, right? So you need to make sure that you build whatever tool you're using, you integrate that tool into your bug tracking system, whatever it is. Maybe you're using Jira, maybe you're using Archer, right? So don't wait and then say, okay, let me wait until the next release in order to see if this is a true issue or a false issue, right? So, and then the last thing is you have to make sure that you have proper gates in your SDLC, right? So you have to make assure your developers that security as much as quality is key, and then give them real-time guidance, right? There are a lot of tools which are available there again at the end of the slide. At the end of the presentation, I'll show you what I have done at Digital at many places. But then it's very important for you as a developer or as a security champion to address every security goal, right? The next thing is, I like this title very much. This is the something which is talked about a lot at Digital. Fix the dang software, right? So like quality, yes, everyone fixes quality issues. But when it comes to security, like I mentioned, no one does it, right? So yeah, a lot of companies focus a lot of time on finding all the security issues, but then stop finding it, right? At one point in time, fix all the issues, right? So unless you find all the issues, you fix all the issues, you prioritize all the issues, there is no point finding all of these issues, right? So, and once you find all of these issues, you must be able to track them, right? Because if you don't know what is happening in your application, there is no point running the tool over and over again, right? And even the next one, the one which I talked here is, don't jump the tracks, right? Your pipeline is broken, your track is broken. So your train is either going to crash or you're going to stop, right? So anytime you find any of these issues, a good mature organization fails big, right? So again, if you see security issues critical, high, again based on the risk management you did, you have to make sure that you break the grid, right? So again, you have to give the same focus level you give for all your quality defects, right? And then incentivize your teams in order to fail the build on security issues. Anytime I talk to any of the teams and tell them, okay, let's fail the build. Let's write a plugin for Jenkins. Of course, we have written several of these plugins. And anytime we see cross-site scripting issue, because this is a banking application, we see SQL injection issue, let's fail the build. The team is very, very nervous. No, we cannot fail the build. So I'm like, what's the point? No, let's push the PDF on the dashboard of Jenkins. Right? So this PDF is almost 300 pages. So who will have the time to download 300 pages and say, okay, in this 60th page, there is a cross-site scripting issue. I need to fix it. Right? No one does that. So it's very important. Of course, a few of the organizations have started doing that, but unless you break the build, no one knows that there were issues which were found out. Right? So I did attend the training yesterday for the new version of Jenkins and the pipeline. So I have like millions of ideas how I can break the build even more better, right? Rather than what we were doing earlier. So it's very easy to break the build and do that. And the next thing is, just like you have all of the other defects, right? Quality defects. You have nice dashboards for them. Also have one for your security defects, right? So whatever you do, whether you do SaaS, whether you do DAS, whether it is in your development environment, it is in your QA, pre-production, push all of them to a metrics dashboard, right? So that is where you will be able to look at it and say, okay, I did all this training, defensive programming training, did I get anything out of that, right? So unless you have metrics, you will not be able to learn anything from whatever you are doing, right? So again, this will also help you improve your time to production. We saw a keynote, right, wherein you can go to production in 16 minutes. But then, can you do all of these, right? So you should be able to do all of that, go into production without compromising your security, right? And if you want to do that, you will have to break your build, right? So how has Jenkins helped me, right? In the beginning, I talked that I have used Jenkins for almost 10 years now. I use cruise control all the way to the beginning. But how has Jenkins helped in doing this, right? So first things first, if you see there, we have helped a lot of SaaS tools with Jenkins and other CI services, right? Yes, there are plugins which are available, but then, like I mentioned, there is no one size fits all. So you cannot just buy a SaaS tool and say, okay, I'm going to integrate it with my Jenkins, right? So we also did a lot of customization for the SaaS tools, right? You don't want to run the same set of rules for every check-in build versus a nightly build versus a weekly build, right? So we did a lot of that customization for enhanced set of SaaS tools for all of those. We also integrated a lot of DAS tools with Jenkins and a few other CI servers. Majority were Jenkins, but then there were a few others. I thought about breaking the build, right? So we did write a lot of custom plugins based on your risk profile. You could configure at runtime saying, okay, for this application, I do not want to see any SQL injection. For this one, I don't care. I don't want to have any critical or high findings, right? So that is something which we wrote. We also wrote a lot of custom plugins for integrating SaaS and DAS to SonarQ as well as a lot of other enterprise dashboards, right? And then again, the first one in this one, send email notifications, it's easily available, right? So the only customization we did was adding a few additional metrics saying who introduced this vulnerability, what happened, and things like that. And then there are a lot of open source tools we use. You see Black Duck outside here for doing dependency check for open source tools. So we have integrated a lot of those in Jenkins. And last but not the least, you're seeing here is again a lot of SonarQ plugins for merging all of the results from SaaS as well as DAS. Because you want to maintain one dashboard where you're looking at all of the results, right? So I have a few deployment models which we use. The first one you're seeing here, we call it as a center of excellence scanning capability. This is where, again, all of the places I did all of these deployment models, whether it's for SaaS or for DAS, was using Jenkins. And a lot of the places we use both the Jenkins master as well as slave. And of course, none of the places did we use the pipeline because this was way earlier. So this is where the application security team or SSG is the one which maintains the Jenkins build server, which you see there in blue. And the next one we did was a self-service scanning factory. This is where the development team is the one which owns the Jenkins master, but then the slave is always owned by the application security team because we want to control what custom rules you create, we want to control what scanning policy is applied. And then there was a third one which we did at a lot of places. It was called as a CI/CD scanning factory, right? So this is where the DevOps team maintained the Jenkins, and then again, even for them, we gave them a series of slaves where the SaaS as well as DAS tools were installed so that they could run their continuous builds on a weekly or a nightly basis. So then we also have a few examples of DAS. This is something very, very challenging, especially when you're doing DAS automation. So what we did is, in this case, we worked closely with the QA team. So we would take all of the scripts which they created for their functional testing and then intercepted the traffic, the HTTP request, and we were able to create a lot of automation using DAS scanners. So this is one of the deployment models for them. And again, even in this case, we use Jenkins as the build server. So those were some of the key things which we used in order to help the challenges people, project, and technology, process and technology. There are a lot of resources which you can see, look at online. any questions, again, get back to me. Why do we hear all day today as well as